4. How the course of past history can now change. So, what has archaeological and anthropological research really taught us since the time of Rousseau? Well, the first thing is that asking about the origins of social inequality is probably the wrong place to start. True, before the beginning of what's called the Upper Paleolithic, we really have no idea what most human social life was like. Much of our evidence comprises scattered fragments of worked stone, bone, and a few other durable materials. Different hominin species coexisted. It's not clear if any ethnographic analogy might apply. Things only begin to come into any kind of focus in the Upper Paleolithic itself, which begins around 45,000 years ago, and encompasses the peak of glaciation and global cooling, around 20,000 years ago, known as the last glacial maximum. This last great ice age was then followed by the onset of warmer conditions and gradual retreat of the ice sheets, leading to our current geological epoch, the Holocene. More clement conditions followed, creating the stage on which Homo sapiens, having already colonized much of the Old World, completed its march into the New, reaching the southern shores of the Americas by around 15,000 years ago. So, what do we actually know about this period of human history? Much of the earliest substantial evidence for human social organization in the Paleolithic derives from Europe, where a species became established alongside Homo neanderthalensis, prior to the latter's extinction around 40,000 BC. The concentration of data in this part of the world most likely reflects a historical bias of archaeological investigation, rather than anything unusual about Europe itself. At that time, and through the last glacial maximum, the habitable parts of Ice Age Europe looked more like Serengeti Park in Tanzania than any present-day European habitat. South of the ice sheets, between the tundra and the forested shorelines of the Mediterranean, the continent was divided into game-rich valleys and steppe, seasonally traversed by migrating herds of deer, bison, and woolly mammoth. Prehistorians have pointed out for some decades, to little apparent effect, that the human groups inhabiting these environments had nothing in common with those blissfully simple, egalitarian bands of hunter-gatherers, still routinely imagined to be our remote ancestors. To begin with, there is the undisputed existence of rich burials extending back in time to the depths of the Ice Age. Some of these, such as the 25,000-year-old graves from Sangir, east of Moscow, have been known for many decades and are justly famous. Felipe Fernandez Armesto, who reviewed Creation of Inequality for the Wall Street Journal, expresses his reasonable amazement at their omission. Quote, "Though they know that the hereditary principle predated agriculture, Mr. Flannery and Miss Marcus cannot quite shed the Rousseauian illusion that it started with sedentary life. Therefore, they depict a world without inherited power until about 15,000 BC, while ignoring one of the most important archaeological sites for their purpose. For, dug into the permafrost beneath the Paleolithic settlement at Sangir, was the grave of a middle-aged man buried, as Fernando Armesto observes, with stunning signs of honor. Bracelets of polished mammoth ivory, a diadem or a cap of fox's teeth, and nearly 3,000 laboriously carved and polished ivory beads. And a few feet away, in an identical grave, lay two children, of about 10 and 13 years respectively, adorned with comparable grave gifts, including, in the case of the elder, some 5,000 beads as fine as the adults, although slightly smaller, and a massive lance carved from ivory. Such findings appear to have no significant place in any of the books so far considered. Downplaying them, or reducing them to footnotes, might be more easy to forgive were Sangir an isolated find. It is not. Comparably rich burials are by now attested from Upper Paleolithic rock shelters and open-air settlements across much of Western Eurasia, from the Don to the Dordogne. Among them we find, for example, the 16,000-year-old Lady of Saint-Germain-la-Riviere, bedecked with ornaments made on the teeth of young stags hunted 300 kilometers away in the Spanish Basque country, and the burials of the Ligurian coast, as ancient as the Sangir, including Il Principe, a young man whose regalia included a scepter of exotic flint, elk antler batons, and an ornate headdress of perforated shells and deer teeth. Such findings pose stimulating challenges of interpretation. Is Fernandez Armesto right to say that these are proofs of inherited power? What was the status of such individuals in life? No less intriguing is the sporadic but compelling evidence for monumental architecture stretching back to the last glacial maximum. The idea that one could measure monumentality in absolute terms is, of course, as silly as the idea of quantifying Ice Age expenditure in dollars and cents. It is a relative concept, which makes sense only within a particular scale of values and prior experiences. The Pleistocene has no direct equivalence in scale to the pyramids of Giza or the Roman Colosseum, but it does have buildings that, by the standards of the time, could only have been considered public works, implying sophisticated design and the coordination of labor on an impressive scale. Among them are the startling mammoth houses, built of hide stretched over a frame of tusks, examples of which, dating to around 15,000 years ago, can be found along a transect of the glacial fringe reaching from modern-day Krakow all the way to Kiev. Still more astonishing are the stone temples of Göbekli Tepe, excavated over 20 years ago on the Turkish-Syrian border, and still the subject of vociferous scientific debate. Dating to around 11,000 years ago, the very end of the last ice age, they comprise at least 20 megalithic enclosures raised high above the now barren flanks of the Harran Plain. Each was made up of limestone pillars over 5 meters in height and weighing up to a ton, respectable by Stonehenge standards, and some 6,000 years before it. Almost every pillar at Göbekli Tepe is a remarkable work of art, with relief carvings of menacing animals projecting from the surface, their male genitalia fiercely displayed. Sculpted raptors appear in combination with images of severed human heads. The carvings attest to sculptural skills, no doubt honed in the more pliable medium of wood, once widely available in the foothills of the Taurus Mountains, before being applied to the bedrock of the Harran. Intriguingly, and despite their size, each of these massive structures had a relatively short lifespan, ending with a great feast and the rapid infilling of its walls. Hierarchies raised to the sky, only to be swiftly torn down again. And the protagonists in this prehistoric pageant play of feasting, building, and destruction were, to the best of our knowledge, hunter-foragers, living by wild resources alone. What, then, are we to make of all this? One scholarly response has been to abandon the idea of an egalitarian golden age entirely, and conclude that rational self-interest and accumulation of power are the enduring forces behind human social development. But this doesn't really work out either. Evidence for institutional inequality in Ice Age societies, whether in the form of grand burials or monumental buildings, is nothing if not sporadic. Burials appear literally centuries and often hundreds of kilometers apart. Even if we put this down to the patchiness of the evidence, we still have to ask why the evidence is so patchy. After all, if any of these Ice Age princes had behaved anything like, say, Bronze Age princes, we'd also be finding fortifications, storehouses, palaces, all the usual trappings of emergent states. Instead, over tens of thousands of years, we see monuments and magnificent burials, but little else to indicate the growth of rank societies. Then there are other, even stranger factors, such as the fact that most of the princely burials consist of individuals with striking physical anomalies, who today would be considered giants, hunchbacks, or dwarfs. A wider look at the archaeological evidence suggests a key to resolving the dilemma. It lies in the seasonal rhythms of prehistoric social life. Most of the Paleolithic sites discussed so far are associated with evidence for annual or biennial periods of aggregation, linked to the migrations of game herds, whether woolly mammoth, steppe bison, reindeer, or, in the case of Göbekli Tepe, gazelle, as well as cyclical fish runs and nut harvests. At less favorable times of year, at least some of our Ice Age ancestors no doubt really did live and forage in tiny bands. But there is overwhelming evidence to show that at others, they congregated en masse with the kind of micro-cities found at Dolní Vestonice in the Moravian Basin south of Brno, feasting on a superabundance of wild resources, engaging in complex rituals, ambitious artistic enterprises, and trading minerals, marine shells, and animal pelts over striking distances. Western European equivalents of these seasonal aggregation sites would be the great rock shelters of the French Perigord and the Cantabrian coast, with their famous paintings and carvings, which similarly formed part of the annual round of congregation and dispersal. Such seasonal patterns of social life endured long after the invention of agriculture is supposed to have changed everything. New evidence shows that alternations of this kind may be key to understanding the famous Neolithic monuments of Salisbury Plain, and not just in terms of calendric symbolism. Stonehenge, it turns out, was only the latest in a very long sequence of ritual structures, erected in timber as well as stone, as people converged on the plain from remote corners of the British Isles at significant times of year. Careful excavation has shown that many of these structures, now plausibly interpreted as monuments to the progenitors of powerful Neolithic dynasties, were dismantled just a few generations after their construction. Still more strikingly, this practice of erecting and dismantling grand monuments coincides with a period when the peoples of Britain, having adopted the Neolithic farming economy from continental Europe, appear to have turned their backs on at least one crucial aspect of it, abandoning cereal farming and reverting, around 3300 BC, to the collection of hazelnuts as a staple food source. Keeping their herds of cattle, on which they feasted seasonally at nearby Durrington Walls, the builders of Stonehenge seem likely to have been neither foragers nor farmers, but something in between. And if anything like a royal court did hold sway in the festive season when they gathered in great numbers, then it could only have dissolved away for most of the year when the same people scattered back out across the island. Why are these seasonal variations important? Because they reveal that from the very beginning, human beings were self-consciously experimenting with different social possibilities. Anthropologists describe societies of this sort as possessing a double morphology. Marcel Mauss, writing in the early 20th century, observed that the circumpolar Inuit, quote, and likewise many other societies, have two social structures, one in summer and one in winter, and that in parallel they have two systems of law and religion, end quote. In the summer months, Inuit dispersed into small, patriarchal bands in pursuit of freshwater fish, caribou, and reindeer, each under the authority of a single male elder. Property was possessively marked, and patriarchs exercised coercive, sometimes even tyrannical power over their kin. But in the long winter months, when seals and walrus flocked to the Arctic shore, another social structure entirely took over, as Inuit gathered together to build great meeting houses of wood, whale rib, and stone. Within them, the virtues of equality, altruism, and collective life prevailed. Wealth was shared, husbands and wives exchanged partners under the aegis of Sedna, the goddess of the seals. Another example were the indigenous hunter-gatherers of Canada's northwest coast, for whom winter, not summer, was the time when society crystallized into its most unequal form, and spectacularly so. Plank-built palaces sprang to life along the coastlines of British Columbia, with hereditary nobles holding court over commoners and slaves, and hosting the great banquets known as potlatch. Yet these aristocratic courts broke apart for the summer work of the fishing season, reverting to smaller clan formations, still ranked, but with an entirely different and less formal structure. In this case, people actually adopted different names in summer and winter, literally becoming someone else depending on the time of year. Perhaps most striking, in terms of political reversals, were the seasonal practices of 19th century tribal confederacies on the American Great Plains. Sometime, or one-time farmers who had adopted a nomadic hunting life in the late summer, small and highly mobile bands of Cheyenne and Lakota would congregate in large settlements to make logistical preparations for the buffalo hunt. At this most sensitive time of year, they appointed a police force that exercised full coercive powers, including the right to imprison, whip, or fine any offender who endangered the proceedings. Yet, as the anthropologist Robert Lowy observed, this unequivocal authoritarianism operated on a strictly seasonal and temporary basis, giving way to more anarchic forms of organization once the hunting season and the collective rituals that followed were complete. Scholarship does not always advance. Sometimes it slides backwards. 100 years ago, most anthropologists understood that those who lived mainly from wild resources were not, normally, restricted to tiny bands. That idea is really a product of the 1960s, when Kalahari Bushmen and Booty Pygmies became the preferred image of primordial humanity for TV audiences and researchers alike. As a result, we've seen a return of evolutionary stages really not all that different from the tradition of the Scottish Enlightenment. This is what Fukuyama, for instance, is drawing on when he writes of society evolving steadily from bands to tribes to chieftains, and then finally the kind of complex and stratified states we live in today, usually defined by their monopoly on the legitimate use of coercive force. By this logic, however, the Cheyenne or Lakota would have had to be evolving from bands directly to states roughly every November, and then devolving back again come spring. Most anthropologists now recognize that these categories are hopelessly inadequate, yet nobody has proposed an alternative way of thinking about world history in the broadest terms. Quite independently, archaeological evidence suggests that in the highly seasonal environments of the last ice age, our remote ancestors were behaving in broadly similar ways, shifting back and forth between alternative social arrangements, permitting the rise of authoritarian structures during certain times of the year, on the proviso that they could not last, on the understanding that no particular social order was ever fixed or immutable. Within the same population, one could live sometimes in what looks, from a distance, like a band, sometimes a tribe, and sometimes a society with many of the features we now identify with states. With such institutional flexibility comes the capacity to step outside the boundaries of any given social structure and reflect, to both make and unmake the political worlds we live in. If nothing else, this explains the princes and princesses of the last ice age, who appear to show up in such magnificent isolation, like characters in some kind of fairy tale or costume drama. Maybe they were almost literally so. If they reigned at all, then perhaps it was, like the kings and queens of Stonehenge, just for a season. 5. Time for a rethink. Modern authors have a tendency to use prehistory as a canvas for working out philosophical problems. Are humans fundamentally good or evil? Cooperative or competitive? Egalitarian or hierarchical? As a result, they also tend to write as if, for 95% of our species' history, human societies were all much the same. But even 40,000 years is a very, very long period of time. It seems inherently likely, and the evidence confirms, that those same pioneering humans who colonized much of the planet also experimented with an enormous variety of social arrangements. As Claude Levi-Strauss often pointed out, early Homo sapiens were not just physically the same as modern humans, they were our intellectual peers as well. In fact, most were probably more conscious of society's potential than people generally are today, switching back and forth between different forms of organization every year. Rather than idling in some primordial innocence until the genie of inequality was somehow uncorked, our prehistoric ancestors seem to have successfully opened and shut the bottle on a regular basis, confining inequality to ritual costume dramas, constructing gods and kingdoms as they did their monuments, then cheerfully disassembling them once again. If so, then the real question is not what are the origins of social inequality, but having lived so much of our history moving back and forth between different political systems, how did we get so stuck? All this is very far from the notion of prehistoric societies drifting blindly towards the institutional chains that bind them. It is also far from the dismal prophecies of Fukuyama, Diamond, Morris, and Scheidel, where any complex form of social organization necessarily means that tiny elites take charge of key resources and begin to trample everyone else underfoot. Most social science treats these grim prognostications as self-evident truths, but clearly they are baseless. So, we might reasonably ask, what other cherished truths must now be cast onto the dust heap of history? Quite a number, actually. Back in the 70s, the brilliant Cambridge archaeologist David Clark predicted that, with modern research, almost every aspect of the old edifice of human evolution, quote, the explanations of the development of modern man, domestication, metallurgy, urbanization, and civilization, may in perspective emerge as semantic snares and metaphysical mirages, end quote. It appears he was right. Information is now pouring in from every quarter of the globe based on careful empirical fieldwork, advanced techniques of climatic reconstruction, chronometric dating, and scientific analyses of organic remains. Researchers are examining ethnographic and historical material in a new light. And almost all of this new research goes against the familiar narrative of world history. Still, the most remarkable discoveries remain confined to the work of specialists, or have been teased out by reading between the lines of scientific publications. Let us conclude, then, with a few headlines of our own, just a handful, to give a sense of what the new, emerging world history is starting to look like. The first bombshell on our list concerns the origins and spread of agriculture. There is no longer any support for the view that it marked a major transition in human societies. In those parts of the world where animals and plants were first domesticated, there actually was no discernible switch from Paleolithic forager to Neolithic farmer. The transition from living mainly on wild resources to a life based on food production typically took something in the order of 3,000 years. While agriculture allowed for the possibility of more unequal concentrations of wealth, in most cases, this only began to happen millennia after its inception. In the time between, people in areas as far removed as Amazonia and the Fertile Crescent of the Middle East were trying farming on for size, play farming, if you like, switching annually between modes of production, much as they switched their social structures back and forth. Moreover, the spread of farming to secondary areas such as Europe, so often described in triumphist terms as the start of an inevitable decline in hunting and gathering, turns out to have been a highly tenuous process which sometimes failed, leading to demographic collapse for the farmers, not the foragers. Clearly, it no longer makes any sense to use phrases like the agricultural revolution when dealing with processes of such inordinate length and complexity. Since there was no Eden-like state from which the first farmers could take their steps on the road to inequality, it makes even less sense to talk about agriculture as marking the origins of rank or private property. If anything, it is among those populations, the Mesolithic peoples, who refused farming through the warming centuries of the early Holocene, that we find stratification becoming more entrenched. At least, if opulent burial, predatory warfare, and monumental buildings are anything to go by. In at least some cases, like the Middle East, the first farmers seem to have consciously developed alternative forms of community to go along with their more labor-intensive way of life. These Neolithic societies look strikingly egalitarian when compared to their hunter-gatherer neighbors, with the dramatic increase in the economic and social importance of women clearly reflected in their art and ritual life. Contrast here the female figurines of Jericho or Katel Hayuk with the hyper-masculine sculptures of Göbekli Tepe. Another bombshell, civilization does not come as a package. The world's first cities did not just emerge in a handful of locations, together with systems of centralized government and bureaucratic control. In China, for instance, we are now aware that by 2500 BC, settlements of 300 hectares or more existed on the lower reaches of the Yellow River, over 1,000 years before the foundation of the earliest Shang royal dynasty. On the other side of the Pacific, and at around the same time, the ceremonial centers of striking magnitude have been discovered in the valley of Peru's Rio Supe, notably at the site of Corral. Enigmatic remains of sunken plazas and monumental platforms, 4 millennia older than the Inca Empire. Such recent discoveries indicate how little is yet truly known about the distribution and origin of the first cities, and just how much older these cities may be than the systems of authoritarian government and literate administration that were once assumed necessary for their foundation. And in the more established heartlands of urbanization, Mesopotamia, the Indus Valley, the basin of Mexico, there is mounting evidence that the first cities were organized on self-consciously egalitarian lines, municipal councils retaining significant autonomy from central government. In the first two cases, cities with sophisticated civic infrastructures flourished for over half a millennium, with no trace of royal burials or monuments, no standing armies or other means of large-scale coercion, nor any hint of direct bureaucratic control over most citizens' lives. Jared Diamond notwithstanding, there is absolutely no evidence that top-down structures of rule are the necessary consequence of large-scale organization. Walter Scheidel notwithstanding, it is simply not true that ruling classes, once established, cannot be gotten rid of except by general catastrophe. To take just one well-documented example, around 200 AD, the city of Teotihuacan in the Valley of Mexico, with a population of 120,000, one of the largest in the world at the time, appears to have undergone a profound transformation, turning its back on pyramid temples and human sacrifice, and reconstructing itself as a vast collection of comfortable villas, all almost exactly the same size. It remained so for perhaps 400 years. Even in Cortez's day, central Mexico was still home to cities like Tlaxcala, run by an elected council whose members were periodically whipped by their constituents to remind them who was ultimately in charge. The pieces are all there to create an entirely different world history. For the most part, we're just too blinded by our prejudices to see the implications. For instance, almost everyone nowadays insists that participatory democracy or social equality can work in a small community or activist group, but cannot possibly scale up to anything like a city, a region, or a nation-state. But the evidence before our eyes, if we choose to look at it, suggests the opposite. Egalitarian cities, even regional confederacies, are historically quite commonplace. Egalitarian families and households are not. Once the historical verdict is in, we will see that the most painful loss of human freedoms began at the small scale. The level of gender relations, age groups, and domestic servitude. The kind of relationships that contain at once the greatest intimacy and the deepest forms of structural violence. If we really want to understand how it first became acceptable for some to turn wealth into power and for others to end up being told their needs and lives don't count, it is here that we should look. Here, too, we predict, is where the most difficult work of creating a free society will have to take place.